I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away. To that land where joy will never end, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Oh, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. In the morning when I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
I wanted to thank you guys for coming today. Most of you know who I am. I'm Howard Jr.'s daughter. May not recognize me in a dress because this is not my thing, but mama's smiling somewhere. I'll start this by saying that yesterday I was down at the beach and I noticed something on the floor, and it was Daddy's pocket knife. He always was losing them everywhere he went. He had one in his pocket. And I wake up in the morning and I expect hearing him say, okay, Sam, what's on the docket for today? That's just his normal thing. If you were here, you meant something special to Dad and to our family. I wanted to thank you for coming. Public speaking is not my thing, along with the dresses. I've asked a couple different people to speak, and we really wanted this to be a celebration of Howard Jr.'s life. He was special to a lot of people, and he was, besides being a dad, a papa, and several of you people know this, the kids called him neighbor. He was known for pulling teeth, taking people to the hospital, and just about anything else in between. And he could talk somebody into painting the underside of a boat and let them think it was something fun to do. A little bit of Tom Sawyer mixed in the middle. He was a little bit of a character, but we all loved him. Wry sense of humor. And I felt what better way to celebrate him is some of the people that knew him best to tell some of their stories and end this on a positive note and a celebration of his life. We were very, very blessed to have him for almost 91 years. He was about 14 days shy. But as most of y'all know, he was a little bit of a character too. He had a very dry sense of humor, and I wanted to ask Jamie to come up and say a few words. And I appreciate all you guys coming. It means a lot to all of us.
How y'all doing today? I'm Jamie Jarvis. For those of you who don't know me, I got the pleasure to grow up about a mile down the street from Howard Forbes, and he was always, you know, trying to teach me because we were a little bit wild, and we'd always try to borrow his bird dogs and bring them back with cocoa burrs all over them and shoot all his shells up and use his bird his dog box and might even burn some of his gas. what he put up with us, and I'm gonna miss him a lot. He used to come to my farm about every, at least a couple of times a week, and he'd go on a walk, and me and him would just kind of walk and look at different tracks in the dirt, and you know, just talk about life and what things were, how things were going. And once my father passed away, Howard used to come up there even more, and he'd give me the opportunity to farm his properties, and he's done a lot for me, and I want to thank y'all. Thank y'all for coming. No, I'm gonna miss him.
We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies drive the dark clouds far away. And will you please say hello to the folks that I know? Tell them that I won't be long, and they'll be happy to know that as you saw me go, I was singing this song. We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Yeah, we'll meet again. I don't know where, and I don't know when, but I do know that we'll meet again some sunny day. So honey, keep on smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies drive the dark clouds far away. And would you please say hello to all the folks that I know, and tell them I won't be long. They'll be happy to know that as you saw me go, I was singing this song. We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.
My name's Bobby. I had the pleasure of growing up around Howard. Howard and my daddy always bird hunted. And when my father passed away, I was 12. So Howard always made sure I was still able to go bird hunting. He'd come pick me up and take me. We always had dogs. And he was a pretty good vet, other than a game warden. He'd help you out with that also. Howard had a pretty easy gait, but we'd be bird hunting, and Robert Furrow would come get in the mix. And Howard seemed to shift gears. We'd get along a lot faster going through the briars or whatever we were doing. Just a lot of fond memories, and he always had the time to listen to you. Another thing Howard was known for was a snow cream. When it was snowed, he'd always call, or I'd call him, and he'd fix up a batch of snow cream. We'd go up to Moyock and eat. The last time before he moved with Rick and Tracy up there, with their family, he called me and we were eating, I'd had a couple of bowls, and he said, "Do you want any more?" I said, "No, sir, I think I'm about topped out." But he convinced me to eat the rest of that pan, and anyway, he said, "It doesn't snow around here like it used to, so you need to take advantage of it." So I ate another bowl and went home with a stomach ache. But I look forward to snowing and whatnot. And this time of the year with the college basketball games going on, my wife's got one team that she's really not fond of, and if Howard saw a team that was playing this particular team, it wouldn't be long he'd call, and Ann could tell who I was talking to by the conversation, and then she'd want to talk to Mr. Howard, and he'd get her stirred up even more, and I'd get the phone back, and he'd kind of be laughing. He said, "I think I've got her wound up for you." I said, "Well, thank you, sir." And we farm, and Howard always asked about her bird report, and for years it's been bad, but anyway, that was something he always asked about. But he was a nice fellow.
Wind blowing on my face, sidewalk flying beneath my back. 5-year-old's first taste of what freedom's really like. He was running right beside me, his hand holding on the sea. I took a deep breath and hollered as I headed for the street. "You can let go now, Daddy. You can let go. Oh, I think I'm ready. Do this on my own. It's still a little bit scary, but I want you to know I'll be okay now, Daddy. You can let go." I was standing at the altar between the two loves of my life. To one I'm a daughter, to one I soon would be a wife. When the preacher asked who gives this woman, Daddy's eyes filled up with tears. He kept holding tightly to my arm till I whispered in his ear, "You can let go now, Daddy. You can let go.
Well, if you knew Dad, you knew he was not a flowery person. He was not going to come out with all this really fancy talking words. He did not mince words, but he was someone that was always there for you. Now, he would give you his opinion. That was coming, especially if it was me. I will miss him so much because he is so much a part of our lives, and he will always be there with me no matter where I go. And I know that. If anybody else would like to come up and say anything, they're welcome to. We've kind of made this a little informal, and I know that Katie would like to speak, but we would really like to thank you for coming. Terry Lee?
Hi, I'm Terry Waterfield. I'm a retired wildlife officer, and I worked with Howard Jr. many a day. I want to thank the wildlife officers that are here today for being here and participating in this celebration, and also the retired wildlife officers that are here. 36 years in one county. I don't know how you do it. I got run out of counties after about 10 years, but he made it for 36. But I can tell you one reason, he was a good man. Howard Jr. was just a good man, that's all you can say. He would help you every way he could. When I first went to work, I was lucky enough to be in his patrol area. I worked with him a lot. He taught me the ropes. He didn't want you to check hunters or duck hunters in the mornings and late afternoons when the duck was flying. He didn't want you to make a case unless you were absolutely positive. He always told me, if you're not sure, give the hunter the benefit of the doubt. It don't cost us anything. But charging somebody that didn't do what you charged them with was a big sin to him. So we had a lot of fun, worked together. He made working fun because he is always joking with you, carrying on. If we weren't sitting in the marsh eating sardines and potted meat, then we were doing something else. I remember I'd been working about a week. And I went up to work with Howard Jr. and he said, well, let's go to Knott's Island and work some dove hunting. I said, yes, sir. So we got over there and, of course, pulled up to this field, and there's a boy out in the middle of the field. He said, you want to go out there and check him? I said, yes, I'll go check him. And when I got out of the car, he said, well, be careful because he might run. I said, I wish he would run. I just got out of wildlife school. I've been running 5 miles every day. Well, I jumped the ditch. He did run. He got up. He had a single-barrel shotgun, a box of shells, and was barefooted. And guess what? He ran across the field in the woods, and I did. I ain't never seen him since. I thought, what am I going to do? I got to go face Howard Jr. I knew this ain't going to be good. I've been knowing Howard Jr. all my life. So anyway, I finally went back, and he said, do you have a license? I said, I don't know. He said, did you check him? I said, no. He said, why not? I said, I ain't never seen him no more. So about 2 weeks later, I went up to work with Howard Jr. He told me, he said, you know, I was over to Pearl's the other day. Pearl's place was a place in Knott's Island. I said, you were? He said, it was a guy in there with a wooden leg. I said, really? He said, yeah. He said he had his knife and he was carving on it. And I asked him what he was doing. He said, well, last week I ate run another game warden. So he tried to insinuate the guy had a wooden leg that I'd run me. So I was like, I don't know. But anyway, that's the way Howard was. He'd get something on you and you had to live with it. But he, another day I got up with him and he said, come on, let's go check some duck hunters. Get your boots, hip boots. I said, yes, sir. So we did and got in the car and we pulled up beside this place and he started across the marsh. Well, I put my boots on and started behind him. Well, we walked and we walked and we walked and we walked and we walked. Said, where in the world are we going? We finally got it over to this duck blind. He said, we're going to sell on this duck blind. Some people are putting illegal ducks in it. I said, okay. So we did, and they did, and we called them. And guess what? Who turned the ducks back out? Me. And I had to have a weight in there to show this rookie officer how they put weights in it and doing it. So I was like, I can't believe he can walk this far in the marsh. And I just got out of wildlife school, and I would give out. But anyway, we had a lot of fun. worked a lot of days together and were good friends. And Tracy and I would play spades sometimes. When I was supposed to be working, I'd go up to Howard's a little early, and as he called her Sam, we'd play spades. Well, Howard would get out in the car and listen on the radio, and he'd come in and say, "We need to go to work, the plane's flying." And Sam would say, "Dad, let's finish this hand, let us finish this hand." Finally, he'd come back in there and say, "Look, Terry, we got a call, we got to go." I said, "All right," so we'd go. But he was just a good person, good friend, and I'm going to miss him. Thank you.
I know many of y'all probably don't recognize me. The last time you saw me, I was probably about 3 foot. I was little Katie, the one he toted around in the car seat right beside him. Anywhere that he went, I was right there beside him. The library, the gas station, anywhere. Went to see the horses. I can remember one time he was sitting there talking, and I saw the horse, and I said, "Well, I've seen him go under the fence. I crawled right under the fence, and he wasn't paying no attention, so I thought I was fine. And I just went up and was petting the horse. He turned around, and he started freaking out, like, "What are you doing?" And I was like, "I thought it was okay." But he was just one of the most caring people. He stepped up to be a dad to me when he didn't have to be. That was just the type of person he was. He did that for a lot of people. But I am so blessed to have had him in my life for so long. And thank y'all for being here today. I know he would be so happy to see every one of y'all.
You stay a little while, keep me safe, 'cause there's monsters right outside. Daddy, please don't go, I don't wanna be alone, 'cause the second that you're gone, they're gonna know. Before he went to bed, he grabbed my hand and said, "Just 'cause I'm leaving, it don't mean take me far away. I know I act tough, but there's a churning in my gut, 'cause I just can't call you up when things get rough. Before I left, he hugged my neck and said, 'Just 'cause you're leaving, it don't mean it. Stay a little
never thought I'd see the day I had to say goodbye. Daddy, please don't go. I can't do this on my own. There's no way that I can walk this road alone. Daddy grabbed my hand and said, just 'cause I'm leaving, it don't mean it. I won't be right by your side when you need me and you can't see me.
My name is Betty Hokett. We were neighbors that lived beside our Howard Jr. for 42 years before we moved away. My children always called him neighbor, and I will never forget every tooth that they've ever had pulled. They'd go over and they would say, neighbor, can you please get this out? He'd send them back home and said, you come back, you go get me a dollar. It's gonna cost you a dollar to get that tooth pulled. They would come home, me and my husband would give them a dollar. They'd go carry it, Howard Jr. would pull the tooth. But when they came home, they said, look what I got, Mom. I said, what? He paid us a dollar to pull it. They were so tickled, and he always, if the children didn't want to go shopping with me, he would say, hey, leave them with me, I'll babysit them, and he did. My children loved him, we all loved him. He's dearly going to be missed, and the most thing that I can think of that Howard done is my husband asked him, could he help him or show him how to cut a wall out, because I wanted a bigger sitting room, living room. And we had a bedroom we didn't use. And Howard told him, Gene said, well, Mom, she's going to be gone today shopping. Can you help me do it? We get it done before she gets back? And he said, okay. Well, they cut the wall out, and it was sheetrock. They never shut a door through the whole house. And when I walked in, got on the porch, all of that white, they called it snow. I said, it's not snow. But Howard Jr., my husband told me, he said, well, about 45 minutes ago, you called and said you were on your way. Howard Jr. said, it's time for me to go home. And he told Gene, he said, I think you need to come with me. Gene said, oh no, she wanted this wall to have a bigger sitting room, and we done what she asked. And when I got home, Howard come out his door. He was peeping. And I should have known then before I hit the porch, because they had tracked all that dust out there. And Howard called Gene. He said, do I need to go over there? And Gene said, no, I got to help clean up. So you just stay home. You've done enough. He asked me, he said, hey, Gene, do I need to come over? I said, no, you and Gene has done all y'all need to do. Y'all just need to get out and go. But he was one wonderful person. I'll never forget. We didn't have air conditioning. I come from the hospital where I had cut my foot out. He went and took an air conditioner, portable one, out of his window and brought it and put it in the bedroom where I was at. He was there. He was there for my children. They all loved him. And there's so many stories, but he is going to be missed when we move. I missed him so much, I wanted to go back up that way because we had been there since Tracy was small. And my children then grew up together, and they love him dearly. We appreciate everybody coming today, and I know everybody's got stories of what he's done, but we got memories that'll never go away of things that we've done together.
Hey everybody, my name's Jennifer. I'm Bud's niece. He was Bud me. Everybody has said Howard, but just a quick little tidbit about me and Bud. We always had the best phone conversations. He was always the best listener. The one thing me and Bud would never, we always agreed not to talk about was politics. And I would say, all right, Bud, we always said we're not going to talk about politics. And then he would ask me another question. I said, no, and then we're not going to talk about politics. But after mine and Susan and Tommy's daddy passed, his relationship became even more defined, and he reminded me of having conversations with my own daddy. And one thing Bud always said, we would get on the phone and he'd say, well, how are you doing? And before I could even get the sentence out, he'd say, well, how's Ron? And that's my husband. And that's what my daddy would always do. Bud adored my husband, and they would talk about college sports, and that was the routine. I would talk to Bud literally for probably an hour, and then I would hand the phone over to Ron, and they would talk sports. And but he will be so missed. He was I could always tell when I was, because my mom passed when I was 12, but I could always tell he was a great big brother to her, just as my brother and sister are to me. He was a protector, and he was a strong man, and he will be missed. So thank you.
Dad had a lot of names, whether it was Dad, Papa, Neighbor, or Bud, as the kids called him. They kind of drew it out when they were little. But the one story that Betty Jean reminded me of, I don't know about some of the enforcement officers, their children, but when I came along, when it was inspection time, it was my time too. And scrubbing boats. And Dad used to paint the underside of the trailers before you didn't have to do that. And I would just yell, and he'd take me by the ankles and pull me a little bit further, and I'd paint a little bit farther. And along with band and ducks, that was one of our routines on an annual basis. And I also do remember some firecrackers. We had to wrap them together. But that's about all I remember. But we were working on both the boats, you know. One was a skiff and one was for the other. And we had the car to do, too. Well, the neighborhood boy next door decided he'd come over, and we had a hose out there. And if you know Dad, even as he got older, was pretty nimble. And, I mean, he could walk, quail hunt, he could go a long distance. I also saw a hog get after him one time. I saw him jump a fence like he was bolting over it. He just, he had his moments. Well, every time that we were working on it, and of course, Wildlife bought these boats that had white seats, and you know what happens to those. Scrubbing those things, I hated those things. And so the kid next door would take the water hose and just lop it over and get us wet. Well, we were inside the boat on the trailer. It's a little hard to get out. And he told him, he said, now, son, if you do that again, I'm going to handcuff you to that pecan tree in the front yard. You're not fast enough. You can't do that. Well, I'm going to tell you something. He may have been older, but he was fast. Last thing I remember is the kid trying to take his feet up the side of the tree. The tree was about 25 feet tall. He said, I can get out of this. This is not a problem. He said, well, you work on that. We're going to finish up on these boats. He did not let him loose until we had moved both boats away from the water hose and we had finished the car. He did a lot of talking, but he was still by the tree when we finished. This was just Daddy's normal, friends would come and visit me. I had a friend that had a baby before the rest of us. And I noticed he came in the room and he said, well, I guess y'all gonna talk all day. He said, let me give me that youngin'. So he went in the other room and played with the kid so we could visit. She had moved away. Dad, we made a volleyball net out of fishing net. You don't ask for something because you're gonna make it out of something we've already got. Cutting a telephone pole in half and mending the net. Now those are skills you learn. They're great for a resume. I just know, but they're not paying much. I'm just telling you. But he was always there, and he was always for my children. For anybody else that needed a helping hand, he was just a good man. Now, I'm a little prejudiced. He's my daddy. But I'm always going to have those memories, and I'm very thankful for the time I had, whether it was with post hole diggers, or and he's telling me a story about how it's so simple, the little Tom Sawyer in there going. But he always kept us going, even when things were not going so hot. He could make something fun that was really not so much fun. I want to thank you guys for coming, and may you be open in your eyes to the memories we have of Dad, Papa, Neighbor, and Bud. Continue retelling his stories, which he had a bunch. He will be missed by all of us, but he's not going to be forgotten. And I hope my kids will never forget them. And I wanted to thank you guys for coming. It really touched our heart to see so many people, because when your dad's 90, a lot of his friends are no longer with you. But I'm amazed the number of people that showed up, and I want to thank you. And my husband was going to finish with a prayer. We're going to have a burial at West Lawn. We'd love to see you guys there.
Yeah, immediately after the service. Is that good? I'm looking at the back of the room here. Well, I didn't get a chance to tell any stories. The son-in-law's always got good stories here now. But I will tell one, and our friends, Andy and Angie Perry back there, were part of this. We went on a trip to the Keys, and it just so happens it's in 1996, and when we got there, Hurricane Andrew was a remote chance of it coming ashore. Well, the closer we got, the less remote the chances became. So, as it turns out, where we were the night before was where the hurricane ended up hitting. So we retreated across the state to one of the couples that we were with to their family home there. So we were back and forth with Mr. Forbes, still calling Mr. Forbes from the day I met him till the day he passed, and Miss Faye. And he was pretty worried about it. I mean, this county knows all about hurricanes. So we were back and forth, and she'll go, and sure enough, Andrew just went right across the state. So all the forecasts were saying it was going to come right where we were. So we were debating on what to do, and Andy and Angie and the other couple decided to stay because they had a nice hurricane-proof house. So we were talking, Tracy was talking to her dad, and this is his quote. He said, I didn't raise my daughter to be any damn fool to stay in the path of a hurricane. Y'all get the hell out of there. So we did. We retreated to Tampa, and I think Andy and Angie could say there was some pretty strong breezes, but we made him happy. So I had a lot of respect for the man. He was better to me than I had any right to have. So I'm proud to have been his son-in-law. So I'm not going to keep anybody here any longer than that. I could tell a few more stories about him flirting at the hospital with all the nurses. I think he asked one of them to marry him before he left, too. He was a good man. And all that being said, I believe for those who want to go to the funeral, I'm going to hold my prayer to their interest of time. I've enjoyed this time here, and it's so good to see so many faces that I've seen before, and some of them have been quite a while. But I think Tracy summed it up so nicely, I'm not going to say another word. So, that being said, for those who want to go to the graveside service, there will be, I'll leave it out to Mr. Twyford here to give instructions. And is that appropriate? Okay. Thank you for coming.